Anything for a laugh. An exploration of the world of comic songs. And doing the exploring is Richard Anthony Baker.
This week, it might hurt a bit, as I look at what comics find so funny about being English. And despite what they think of us abroad, we do, of course, have a sense of humour. It's just that it's concealed by the fact that we don't laugh very much. How often have you heard a conversation between two Englishmen in which they continually joke with each other, but during which their faces don't crack? To laugh would somehow be giving the game away. It's this stoicism which is at the heart of Englishness, plus the unshakable confidence in anything to do with people who have the misfortune to be born abroad, that we are innately right.
The English are best. I wouldn't give tuppence for all of the rest.
And crossing the channel, one cannot say much. Or the French, or the Spanish, the Danish, or Dutch.
The Germans are German, the Russians are red.
And the Greeks and Italians eat garlic in bed.
The English are moral, the English are good. And clever and modest and misunderstood.
And all the world over, each nation's the same.
They've simply no notion of playing the game.
They argue with umpires, they cheer when they've won,
and practice beforehand, which ruins the fun.
The English are best. So up with the English and down with the rest.
It's not that they're wicked or naturally bad. It's knowing they're foreign that makes them so mad.
For the English are all that a nation should be. And the flower of the English
is Nigel,
Alistair, Anthony,
Slimer,
Ryle, Flanders and Swan,
and me.
I'm not old enough to remember the English at war with anyone, but how infuriating it must be to perceive that sense of superiority in your enemy. The Kingsingers, six Englishmen through and through, singing the song of two purebred Englishmen, Flanders and Swan, who succeeded in capturing American audiences with just dinner jackets, a grand piano, a standard lamp, and their talent. Here are the Kingsingers again with the international anthem of what every foreigner finds so funny about us.
In tropical climes at a certain time of day, when all the citizens retire to take their clothes off and perspire, it's one of those rules that the greatest fools obey. Because the sun is much too sultry and one must avoid it.
Sultry violet rain.
Papalaka, 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 boo. Papalaka, 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 boo. Digga, 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 doo. Digga, 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 doo.
The natives grieve and the white men leave their huts.
Because they're obviously, definitely
mad dogs. And Englishmen go out to the midday sun.
The Japanese don't care to. The Chinese wouldn't dare to.
The Hindus and Argentines keep firm with 12 to 1.
But Englishmen detest a
siesta.
In the gloomy leaves there are lovely screens to protect you from the glare.
In the very last days that a hat like patience the Britishers won't wear.
At 12 noon the natives swoon and know that the work is done.
But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
Oh, it's such a surprise to the Eastern eyes to see that though the English are effete, they're quite impervious to heat. When the white man rides, every native hides in glee, because the simple creatures hope he will impale his soul atopy on the tree. Heaven in heaven in heaven in heaven, the same natives pay no attention. Digga, 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 digga. It seems to shame when the English claim the earth that they give rise to such hilarity and mirth. Oh dear, mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday sun. The smallest Malay rabbit deplores this foolish habit in Hong Kong. They strike a gong and fire off an all-day gun to reprimand each inmate who's in late. In a jungle town where the sun beats down to the rage of man and beast, the English garb of the English sub merely gets a bit more creased. In Bangkok at 12 o'clock they foam at the mouth and run, but mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the winter sun. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. The toughest Burmese bandit can never understand it. In Rangoon, the heat of noon is just what the natives shun. They put their scotch or rye down and lie down. In the mangrove swamps where the python romps, there is peace from 12 till 2. Even caribous lie around and snooze, for there's nothing else to do. In Bengal, to move at all is seldom, if ever, done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday, 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 sun.
Noel Coward was terribly bucked when that title of his appeared in the Oxford Dictionary of Quotations, even though scholars were quick to point out that he may not have been the originator precisely. A Guide to Malta, written in the 1870s, a good 60 years before the song, referred to the heat of the sun, adding, "Only newly arrived Englishmen and mad dogs expose themselves to it." Let's take another of Coward's favourite subjects, England's stately homes, and hear from a review entertainer who's something of a national institution in his own right. I'll let him introduce himself.
Good evening. Well, just to introduce myself and some of the songs that I wrote and sang in cabaret, I'm Douglas Byng. I entertained at supper the smarter members of the class called upper, those idle rich who never went to bed and clamoured for amusement while they fed, where debutantes acquired the champagne habit in evening wraps of ermine or white rabbit, and actresses with tempers and with sables raised hell because they hadn't centre tables. My songs were said to be a trifle risky, but made the nicest hour just so frisky. Sedate black-jetted bosoms heaved with laughter. Ooh, what has he said now? Their daughters pointed jokes out to them after. And though the tone of Mendelssohn's own spring song may perhaps be more artistic than a Byng song, I still maintain I've nothing to feel shy about. I told the young those things that parents lie about.
For generations, Douglas Byng told the young those things that parents lie about, mostly in the guise of a bizarre range of women. He has trilled, "I'm Doris the Goddess of Wind," again with a straight face. And long before Penelope Keith found herself to the manor born, Dougie was privy to the secrets of the big house.
Now, throughout the English countryside, from manor house to farm, I'm held by all in very high esteem. And I must confess, I do possess that dignified and calm and ruffled manner of the creamy de la creme. No doubt you all are wondering what class I represent, a question I do not intend to dodge. Well, like the landed gentry, I don't pay any rent. No, I guard two ancient manor gates residing in the lodge. So though I'm not exactly the elite, I nestle in the comfort of a squire's country seat. I'm old Nana, the keeper of the manor, in and out the lodge all day. Popping out and bobbing when the gentry come to call, stopping little boys from writing rude things on the wall. Everybody knows me, all the village owes me money, which they don't intend to pay. Yes, at Easter when the vicar calls to ask the squire for alms, oh, he pops in for a cup of tea, I still have me hidden charms. And he always leaves his prayer book and 10 shillings in the Psalms, in and out the lodge all day. Now, I've always been in service with the aristocracy, and I'm proud of the connection there, I'm sure. But I dallied in the dukeries when I was 23, and some extremely funny goings on I saw. All day they hunted foxes, and God knows what at night. Those house parties, you wondered where you were. One night they played a game called Truth, and no one went to bed. Oh, well, after that we never knew who really was there. Oh, our manor house is very much alive. So Nana, Flaunce, Banner down at this end of the drive. Yes, I always say live near the gates. Then when you give a party, you do know who's gone home. And when you have guests, make the beds early. Then they can always pop into them if they want to. Oh, I shall never forget the young squire's coming of age. What a day that was. The county, the gentry, the nobility. Talk about noblesse oblige. Everyone was obliging everybody else before they were asked. Then a very large lady from London sang some folk songs. Oh, she was very large. Her outline was extremely odd. Well, she was a good all-round performer. I was standing next to the vicar at the time, and he turned to me and he said, Nana, I don't mind her old English ditties, but I don't like her London derriere. I said, well, why talk French to me, vicar? Then I went and talked to a gentleman from the city. He was a financier, I think. He said, you know, Nana, everything I seem to touch goes wrong. I said, well, don't touch me then. But as I was saying, at the young squire's party, we were just going home, just snipping through the hedge, when the village idiot rushed forward and did something very peculiar. Oh, very uncalled for. But the young squire was equal to the occasion. Oh, he hadn't been to the university for nothing. He just waved it aside and said, Ars est celeria artem to you. I don't know what it meant, but I think it meant, if that's art, conceal it. I'm old Nana, the keeper of the manor, in and out the lodge all day. Popping out and bobbing when the gentry come to call. Stopping little dogs, little boys, from writing rude things on the wall. Everybody knows me, all the village owes me money, which they never mean to pay. Oh, they say the manor's haunted, full of ghosts with eyes that shine. So I slept up there one Christmas, lots of guests and lots of wine. But all I heard were gentle taps on every door but mine. In and out the lodge all day.
Yes, it's not just those at the top of the social ladder who've attracted the comic's attention. Those close to the throne are also seen to have their funny side. And what of the social climber with illusions of grandeur? That image was surely best summed up in this song, written by William Hargreaves in 1915 and made famous by his wife.
I'm Bert. And perhaps you've heard of me, Bert. Oh, you've had word of me. Well, I've been plodding along, and I'm happy and I'm strong. I've been living on plates of fresh air. I dress. I dress up in fashion. And when I am feeling depressed, well, I shave my cuffs, all the whiskers and fluff, stick my hat on, and toddle up west. I'm Burlington Bertie, and I rise at 10:30. I saunter along like a tom. I walk down the Strand with my gloves on my hand. then I walk down again with them all. I'm all airs and graces, correct easy paces. So long without food, I forgot where my face is. I'm Bert. Bert? Oh, I haven't a shirt. My people, they're well off, you know. Nearly everyone knows me, from Smith to Lord Rosebery. I'm Burlington Bertie, from Bow. My pose, though ironical, shows that my monocle holds up my face and keeps it in place, stops it from slipping away. Cigars, oh cigars, I smoke thousands. I usually deal in the Strand. Oh, but you have to take care when you're getting them there, or some idiot might step on your hand. I'm Burlington Bertie, and I rise at 10:30. Then Buckingham Palace I view. I stand in the yard while they're changing the guard, and the king shouts across, Toodaloo! The Duke of Windsor's brother, along with some other, slaps me on the back and says, come and see mother. I'm Bert. Bert, royalty's hurt. When they ask me to dine, I say no. I've just had a banana with Lady Diana. I'm voting for voting for.
The male impersonator, Ella Shields, with one of London's best loved music hall songs. Songs about London were all the rage at one time. Mari Lloyd sang The Piccadilly Trot, Victoria Monk's Give My Regards to Leicester Square, and Charles Whittle, who nobody remembers, sang the song everybody remembers, Let's All Go Down the Strand. It takes a sense of humour as distorted as Spike Milligan's to go a few feet below street level, where, needless to say, the stench is so bad, the usual reaction is...
Yes, folks, I can understand their feelings because they are about to play sideways through the sewers of the Strand on a Sunday afternoon.
Who's that, folks?
Sideways through the sewers of the Strand will be our honeymoon. Ankle deep, folks, in sludge, dear, we'll walk hand in hand. They do say that the sewers of the Strand are the finest in the land. Sideways through the sewers of the Strand will be paradise for two. Who cares if the atmosphere is blue? There's nothing wrong,
yes,
with a good old British bong. Sideways through the sewers of the train, either you la da ti ba da hi ba ya da moi ho. Ah, my darling little bride, we met by accident, folks. She ran over me in a tram. Her name was Beulah. Mine was Jim. I was glad they called me Jim Fox, because that was my name. I found out that she'd been going out with an Irish dentist called Phil McCavity. He walked with a pronounced limp. L-I-M-P, pronounced limp, folks. Oh, the worry turned me gray. This gave me a strange appearance, as I was bald at the time. The first time I met her was late, early one morning in spring. There was a heavy dew on the grass. He'd just been thrown out of a synagogue preaching during the sermon. I told her, darling, let me take you away from the squalor you live in and live in the squalor I live in. So we were married in the spring, folks. We had the reception in the pond. There was plenty to drink, folks. And then off we went, folks. Sideways through those naughty sewers of the naughty Strand will be a paradise for two, not one, but two, folks. Who cares if the atmosphere is blue? Who said that? Cause there's nothing wrong, is there, with a good old British bong? Sideways through the sewers of the Strand with you, I don't mean maybe.
Wait a minute.
And there Spike, being Spike, leaves it to make way for a London comedian of a previous generation, Gus Elan. One of his most famous songs seemed to cock a snook at those estate agents' descriptions of houses, all euphemism and little fact. It was written by one of the top men in Francis Day and Hunter, Edgar Bateman, who, while living in a square not far from King's Cross Station, realised one evening that, when looking east, he'd be able to see the Hackney Marshes, if it wasn't for the houses in between. The man who made it famous recorded it more than 50 years ago.
If you saw my little backyard, what a pretty spot you'd cry. It's a picture on a sunny summer's day. With the turnip tops and cabbages, what people doesn't buy, I make it on a Sunday look all gay. The neighbours thinks I grow 'em, and you'd fancy your intent or at Epsom if you gaze into the mews. It's a wonder as the landlord doesn't want to raise the rent, because we've got such knobby distant views. Oh, it really is a very pretty garden, and Chingford to the eastward could be seen. With a ladder and some glasses, you could see to Acme Marshes, if it wasn't for the houses in between. We're as countrified as can be, with a close prop for a tree. The tap stool makes a rustic little style. Every time the blooming clock strikes, there's a cuckoo sings to me, and I've painted up to Lever Lane a mile. I wears this milkman's nightshirt, and I sits outside all day, like the flower boy cove what mizzled all the leaves. And when I goes indoors at night, they don't know what I say, cause me language gets as yokel as can be. Oh, it really is a very pretty garden, and the soapworks from the house tops could be seen. If you got a rope and pulley, you'd enjoy the breeze more fully, if it wasn't for the houses in between. There's the bunny shares the egg box with the cross-eyed cockin' in, though they have got the pip and him the morph. In a dog's ass on the line post there was pigeons 9 or 10, till someone took the brick and knocked it off. The dust cart, though it seldom comes, is just like harvest home, and we mean to rig a dairy up somehow. Put the donkey in the washers with some imitation horns, cause we're teaching him to moo just like a car. Oh, it really is a very pretty garden, and ending to the westward could be seen. And by climbing up the chimney, you could see across to Wembley, if it wasn't for the houses in between.
Ernest Augustus Elan, Gus Elan, with a distinctly parochial look at London. Next week, I'll look at how we used to poke fun at foreigners. That was before the world was made smaller by fearless adventurers and explorers, among whose number we may raise a cheer for Captain Spaulding.
At last we are to meet him, the famous Captain Spaulding, from climate hot and scalding, the captain has arrived.
Hello, I must be going. I cannot stay, I came to say I must be going. I'm glad I came, but just the same, I must be going.
For my sake, you must stay. If you should go away, you'll spoil the party I am throwing.
I'll stay a week or two. I'll stay the summer through, but I am telling you, I must be a-going.
Before you go, will you oblige us
and tell us of your deeds so glowing?
I'll do anything you say. In fact, I'll even stay.
Good.
But I must be going.
Hooray for Captain Spaulding, the African explorer.
Did someone call me Schnorrer?
Hooray, hooray, hooray. He went into the jungle where all the monkeys throw nuts.
If I stay here, I'll go nuts.
Hooray, hooray, hooray.
I put all my reliance in courage and defiance, and risk my life for science. Hey, hey!
One day in Madagascar, he bagged a dozen weasels.
Yes, and all of them had measles.
Hooray, hooray, hooray.
Hooray for Captain Spaulding, the African explorer. Hooray, hooray, hooray.
The first day I arrived in Africa.
Hooray for Captain Spaulding, the African explorer. Hooray, hooray, hooray.
The first day I arrived in Africa.
Hooray for Captain Spaulding, the African explorer. Hooray, hooray, hooray.
The first day I arrived. Hooray for Captain. Fooled you that time, didn't I?
Doing the fooling, Groucho Marx. Travel is surely not now the fun it was in Captain Spaulding's time. If you're anything like me, your heart sinks as you drive to the airport, knowing that something's going to stop you flying where you want to, and if it doesn't stop you, it's not going to be much fun anyway. Still, we manage not to resist it.
Lloyd tells me,
yes,
never go by plane.
Mm-hmm.
I tell Lloyd,
he does,
flying is insane.
True.
We agree, we would rather die. We see a brochure and sign for a tour, and what do? We fly.
I think it takes longer to get to the airport than it does to get to Europe.
It starts the minute you check in. Departure time is at noon. A cup of tea and a schnecken, and quick, it's leaving soon. 1 o'clock and you're at the gate. 2 o'clock and the flight's still late. When you finally leave, it's eight. And what do? We fly.
We fly.
What do? We fly. I hate flying. I've seen three of
you.
I do never get a rest
about
I hate planes.
I hate every single one. The crossing was rough, which wasn't enough. The fun hadn't yet begun.
On our plane, we ran into an electrical storm, and there was this lady with a hearing aid.
The seat was throwing my back out, but there I was with a book. When suddenly there's a blackout, and everywhere I look is a close-up of Doris Day. 90 minutes of Doris Day. There was nothing to do but pray. And how do we go? We fly. Why? How do we go? We fly.
My mother won't even get off the ground.
You should see her.
I hate flying a dream.
Most of all the
sun. Like me.
I hate plans.
A dream.
Even on the ground.
You
can't
stand by.
I hate even more than those. The kids in the aisle surrounding you while their parents pretend to doze. I don't think the airlines allow babies unless they promise to cry. The kid I noticed the first was the one who stood on my feet. The kid I hated the worst was the one who kicked my seat. There was one on the left who bit. There was one on the right who spit. There was one in the back I hit. But what did we do? We flew. Ooh, what did we do? We flew.
I hate flying.
Never can the dawn like me.
I hate flying.
That
always feel I'm drafty. You
can't
stand planes.
I hate most of all the chow. To know what is difficult, but I think I've discovered how. You are just about to fall asleep.
Uh-huh.
When they shove a tray at you.
That's true.
The shiny stuff is tomatoes. The salad lies in a group. The curly stuff is potatoes. The stuff that moves is soup. Anything that is white is sweet. Anything that is brown is meat. Anything that is gray, don't eat. But what do? We fly. Why? What do? We fly.
I remember Penny telling you about that lady with the hearing aid. Well,
you're zooming up like a comet. Your ears are starting to ring. Your neighbor's starting to vomit. There's ice along the wing. As you wait for your palms to dry, you can see your whole life flash by. And they tell you it's fun to fly. Your chances of survival so remote, you're far better off to cut your throat. But who has the time to take the book? What do? We fly.
A song from the pen of, may I call him the best lyricist at work today, Stephen Sondheim, in collaboration there with Richard Rodgers for the otherwise hapless show, Do I Hear a Waltz? So, next week, forgetting the advice that anything that's white is sweet, anything that's brown is meat, anything that's grey, don't eat, we venture abroad in the company of Billy Merson, Mari Lloyd, as well as Noel Coward, Flanagan and Allen, and the Weston Brothers. Until then, goodbye.
Thank you.
Anything for a Laugh was written and presented by Richard Anthony Baker and produced by Alan Owen.
The time now of 11 o'clock. This is David Bellon at the radio.